Good day, everyone. Today, we will discuss about the antimicrobial susceptibility testing. So first of all, let's define what is AST or antimicrobial susceptibility testing. It is also known as the sensitivity testing. Susceptibility testing is used to determine which antimicrobials or antibiotics will inhibit the growth of the bacteria or fungi causing a specific infection. So, what is the importance of susceptibility testing? First, the results from this test helps to determine which drugs or antibiotics are likely to be most effective in treating a person's infection. So with the help of AST, with the help of the AST result that we will provide to the physician, it helps in the proper prognosis of the patient. Also, aids in the evaluation of treatment services provided by hospitals, clinics, and national programs for control and prevention of infectious diseases. And lastly, monitor for resistance patterns due to the mutations in bacterial DNA. Antimicrobial susceptibility testing, helping physicians determine the appropriate antimicrobials. So in this diagram, it shows us the step-by-step procedure on how we provide the AST result to the physician. So first, infection occurs, followed by taking patient sample, taken and empiric therapy given. Third, AST conducted on sample. Fourth, therapy adjusted based on the AST result. And lastly, patient response to the treatment. Standardizations in vivo. Different standards or methodology. So there are two organizations that establish the standardization of AST methodology. One is the CLSI. CLSI stands for Clinical and Laboratory Standards Institute. Another is the EUCAST or the European Committee on Antimicrobial Susceptibility Testing. Always remember that the standard AST medium is the MHA agar or the Mueller-Hinton agar or Mueller-Hinton broth. Like for example, the one that is in the picture. Standardized inoculum should be ATCC strain or American type culture collection strain, isolation and standardizing the bacterial suspension by McFarland standards. Performing tests under standard conditions. Incubation time and temperature should be considered. Volume of the media used, the size and dilution of the inoculum should also be considered. And lastly, the pH and contents of the medium. Use of QC strains for further check and reference. Okay, so in this slide, it shows us a diagram. There are actually three methods on how we perform AST testing. So there are actually three methods on how we perform the antimicrobial susceptibility testing. One is through phenotypic methods. When you say phenotypic method, this is based on the physical characteristics or the physical properties of the bacteria. Another method on how we perform AST is through molecular-based methods. When you say molecular-based methods, this is based on genotypic identification. And when you say genotypic identification, based on the genetic composition of the bacteria. And another one is through mass spectrometry. In today's discussion, we will only discuss the phenotypic methods. The phenotypic methods of testing antimicrobial susceptibility. So for the sake of this discussion, we will only limit our discussion with the physical methods or phenotypic methods, including the broth dilution method, followed by the agar dilution method, the disc diffusion method, also known as the Kirby-Bauer testing, and lastly, the test. Okay. So first, we will discuss about the broth dilution method. Methods for testing antimicrobial susceptibility. Commercial systems like health centers and hospital facilities utilize both phenotypic and genotypic characterization of bacterial resistance. As I mentioned earlier, there are actually a lot of methods of AST testing. One is through phenotypic identification, followed by genotypic characterization, and there's another one through mass spectrometry. Qualitative results indicate how a bacteria may respond to a drug in vivo. Quantitative result indicated by MIC or the minimal inhibitory concentration. Okay? Let's define what is MIC. MIC is actually an acronym that stands for minimum inhibitory concentration. When you say MIC, we are referring to the lowest concentration of a drug or antibiotic that will inhibit the visible growth of a microorganism after overnight incubation. Again, MIC refers to the lowest concentration of the drug or antibiotic that will inhibit the growth of the microorganism. MIC can be determined by culturing microorganisms in liquid media or on plates of solid growth medium. Always remember that a lower MIC value indicates that less drug is required for inhibiting growth of the organism. Therefore, drugs with lower MIC scores are more effective antimicrobial agents. Always remember that their relationship is inversely proportional. Means to say, the lower the MIC, more effectiveness from the drug. I repeat, the lower the MIC, more effective is the antimicrobial agent. Okay? By identifying appropriate drugs and their effective concentrations, MIC scores aid in improving outcomes for patients and prevention evolution of drug-resistant microbial strains. All right, so let's now discuss, guys, the different phenotypic methods of antimicrobial susceptibility testing, starting with the test tube dilution method, also known as the broth dilution method. It involves challenging the organism of interest with antimicrobial agents in a broth environment, specifically the Mueller-Hinton broth. Specific amount of antibiotics prepared in a decreasing concentration in broth by serial dilution techniques and standard numbers of the test organism is inoculated. Okay. The standard inoculum size used in the test tube dilution method is 5 times 10 raised to the 5th CFU per ml or colony-forming units per ml. This method can be used to determine both the MIC and MLC concentration. So not just MIC, okay? Another advantage of this method is that we're also able to know the MLC or the minimal lethal concentration of the drug or antibiotic, okay? When you say MLC, minimal lethal concentration, we are referring to the lowest concentration of the drug or antimicrobial agent that can kill or destroy the microorganism. So, aside from MIC, we're also able to know the MLC concentration of the drug using this method, the test tube dilution method. All right, so in this slide, in this diagram, it summarizes the steps of the test tube dilution method. So the first step, we will perform tube dilution. Step number two, incubate those test tubes for 24 hours. And step three, determine MIC based on turbidity. Let me give you example, guys. Okay, so for example, as you can see here, we have a series of test tubes, right? So as you can see here in our diagram, we have a series of test tubes. And each test tube contains Müller-Hinton broth with specific concentrations of antibiotic, okay, in microgram per ml. So again, we have series of test tubes. Each test tube contains Müller-Hinton broth with specific concentrations of antibiotic in micrograms per ml. Like for example, this test tube contains 0 micrograms per ml. So it means to say it's just purely Müller-Hinton broth with no antibiotic. Second, this test tube contains 0.125 micrograms per ml of the antibiotic, 0.25 micrograms per ml antibiotic, 0.5 micrograms per ml, 1 micrograms per ml, 2 micrograms per ml, and 4 micrograms per ml. So if you can observe, class, it's in increasing concentration. It can be increasing or decreasing concentration as long as it has the proper sequence. Okay? And then what you will do is that you will put the bacterial inoculum in each test tube coming from the standardized bacterial suspension. Okay, and then you will incubate for 24 hours. After incubation, you observe turbidity. Okay, you observe turbidity. Okay, so after 24 hours of incubation, as you can see here, there are some test tubes that showed visible growth of the bacteria, means to say they showed turbidity, while the others show no visible growth. Okay? Always remember our rule. Always remember our rule. Turbidity equals turbidity, okay, equals visible growth. Okay? If the broth showed turbidity, that means the bacteria was able to grow in that particular broth. Okay? So in this example, as you can see, test tube number 1, 2, 3, and 4 showed visible growth of the bacteria. Okay? Turbid. While the others, test tubes number 5, 6, and 7 showed no visible growth. Okay? Our objective here is for us to know the MIC. Again, MIC. Minimal inhibitory concentration is defined as the lowest concentration of the antibiotic, the lowest concentration of the antibiotic that inhibited the growth of the bacteria. So which do you think? In our example, which do you think is the MIC or the lowest antibiotic concentration that inhibited the growth of the bacteria? If your answer is 1 micrograms per ml, you're correct. Okay? 1 micrograms per ml is the MIC in this particular example. Why? Because it fulfills the definition of MIC. Again, what is the definition of MIC? Going back, okay? When you say MIC, it refers to the lowest concentration of the antibiotic that showed inhibition. In our example, 1 micrograms per ml is the specific antibiotic concentration that inhibited the growth of the bacteria. Okay? Why not 2 and 4? Because 2 and 4 are too high. Okay? Take note, we are searching for the lowest concentration that inhibited the growth of the bacteria. Why not less than 1? That is because in this particular antibiotic concentrations, the bacteria still managed to grow. Again, we are searching for that specific antibiotic concentration that inhibited the growth of the bacteria. So in our example, the answer is 1. Okay? So I hope you got that right. Okay? 1 micrograms per ml. We have two types of test tube dilution method. We have number 1, the broth microdilution method, and number 2, the broth macrodilution method. The only difference between the two is the broth volume that is being used in each test tube. Okay? Micro means small. In each test tube, it only contains 0.05 to 0.1 ml of the Mueller-Hinton broth. Other alternatives, you can also use the Scheddler's broth, the West-Wilkins broth, and the BHI, or the Brain Heart Infusion Agar. Macro means large. It uses large broth volumes. So in each test tube, it contains more than 10 ml. Mueller-Hinton broth with 2% sodium chloride is used to improve detection of the ORSA, or the oxacillin-resistant Staphylococcus aureus, since this bacteria is halophile. All right, so we're done with the test tube dilution method. Let's now move on with the agar dilution method. This is almost similar with the test tube dilution method. Same concept, almost the same principle. The only difference between the two, instead of using test tube that contains broth, okay, here in this particular method, we use agars, okay? So instead of using test tubes which contains Mueller-Hinton broth, here we use agars, okay? That's the reason why they name it as the agar dilution method. So the antimicrobial concentrations and organisms to be tested are brought together in an agar-based medium rather than in a broth. Okay? Please always remember the standard inoculum size used in each method. In the case of agar dilution method, it uses 1 times 10 raised to the 4th coliforming units per ml. Shelf life of agar dilution plate is only 1 week for most antimicrobial agents. The agar dilution method is the reference method. We see reference method. This is already the gold standard. Okay? The gold standard phenotypic method. Okay? In performing AST testing for anaerobes and Neisseria gonorrhea. As I mentioned, this is the reference AST phenotypic method for anaerobes, obligate anaerobes. For anaerobes, we use Brucella agar with lake blood and vitamin K, what we call as the Wadsworth method. So as I mentioned a while ago, the other dilution method is almost similar concept, almost similar principle behind the test tube dilution method, the one that we discussed previously. The only difference is that instead of using broth, we use agars, okay? Mueller-Hinton agars. So in this diagram, as you can see, we have several agars, okay? And each agar contains specific antibiotic concentrations. Agar number one, for example, it contains 0.5 micrograms per ml antibiotic concentration, 1 micrograms per ml antibiotic concentration for agar number 2, for agar number 3, 2 micrograms per ml, 4 micrograms per ml, 8 micrograms per ml, 16, and 32. Increasing concentrations. Okay? So all you need to do is to inoculate, okay? You inoculate the bacteria coming from the standardized bacterial suspension, okay? And then you incubate for 24 hours. After 24 hours of incubation, you observe for visible growth of the bacteria. Like for example, in this example, as you can see, there are visible growths of bacteria. Why? Because the antibiotic concentration is still not enough, okay, to inhibit the growth of the bacteria. Take note, it's too little, 0.5 micrograms per ml. Here, there are still a lot, okay? There are still a lot of visible growths of bacteria. So it's not yet enough, okay? 1 micrograms per ml is not yet enough to inhibit their growth. Okay, here, as you can see, there is still visible growths of the bacteria. 4 micrograms per ml, although majority, okay, of its portion, as you can see, there are already no visible growth, but still, there is a little visible growth of the bacteria. Starting at 8, okay, and up, there are already no visible growth of the bacteria. So, in this example, what do you think is the MIC? The answer is 8 micrograms per ml. Okay, 8 micrograms per ml. Why 8 micrograms per ml? That is because this is the lowest antibiotic concentration that inhibited the growth of the bacteria. Okay? So almost the same concept or almost the same principle with that of the test tube dilution method. Let's move on with the disc diffusion method, also known as the Kirby-Bauer test. This is the most commonly used AST method. I repeat, the most commonly used AST method. It involves qualitative measurement, the disc diffusion method. Okay, it was devised by Kirby-Bauer, okay, named after its inventor, Kirby-Bauer. However, although this is the most commonly used, it has limitation. Okay? This method, you can only use this if you want to perform AST among aerobic and facultative anaerobic bacteria. Okay? So again, this diffusion method, this can only be used among aerobic and facultative anaerobic bacteria. It is based on the principle diffusion, okay? Going back to your lower sciences, when you say diffusion, it is defined as the movement of analytes or particles, okay, from a high concentration to a low concentration. Okay. These are what we call filter paper discs. Okay. And each filter paper disc contains specific amount or specific antibiotic concentrations. So once this, like for example, this one, this filter paper disc touches the surface of the Mueller-Hinton agar, from the center of this filter paper disc, the antibiotic particles will move from the center going to the edge. Okay? Filter paper discs impregnated with various antimicrobial agents of specific concentrations are carefully placed on an agar plate previously inoculated with the bacterium being tested. Okay? These are what we call filter paper discs or simply antibiotic discs. This filter paper disc contains a specific antimicrobial agent with specific concentration. Like for example, in this particular filter paper disc, what is the specific antimicrobial agent? Clindamycin. What is its specific concentration? 10 micrograms per ml. Okay? So this filter paper disc will be carefully placed on a Mueller-Hinton agar that is previously inoculated with the bacterium being tested. Okay? And then after incubation for at least 16 to 24 hours or overnight incubation, you will measure the diameter of the incubation zone, which reflects the MIC. The standard inoculum size used in the disc diffusion method is 1.5 times 10 raised to the 8 CFU per ml. Okay, I repeat, 1.5 times 10 raised to the 8 CFU per ml. And again, the susceptibility standard medium is the Mueller-Hinton agar or the MHA. Okay, so in this slide, it summarizes the step-by-step procedure on how to perform the Kirby-Bauer disc diffusion method. So first, get MHA or the Mueller-Hinton agar. You inoculate the Mueller-Hinton agar plate. So first, you get a Kirby-Bauer, sorry, you get Mueller-Hinton agar, and then you inoculate the bacterium being tested coming from the standardized bacterial suspension. Okay? You will flood. Okay? You will flood the Mueller-Hinton agar using the standardized bacterial suspension. Okay, and then you will carefully place, okay? You will carefully place or you will add the different filter paper discs with specific antibiotic concentrations in the agar previously inoculated with the bacterium being tested. Okay? And then you will incubate. Okay, you will incubate overnight or 16 to 24 hours. Please take note that the standard incubation time is 16 to 24 hours or overnight incubation. Okay, after incubation for 16 to 24 hours, you will measure, no, the diameter. You will measure the diameter, okay, of the incubation zone that was created surrounding the disc, okay, using caliper or vernier caliper. This instrument is what we call vernier caliper or simply caliper. Okay, so again, you will measure the inhibition zone or the zone of inhibition using vernier caliper. and the unit should be in millimeters. Okay? So again, Kirby-Bauer, this diffusion method is based on the principle diffusion. Okay? And diffusion is defined as the movement of analytes or particles from a higher concentration to a lower concentration. Okay? This particular antimicrobial disc, for example, has a high concentration of the antibiotic. Okay? Most especially at its center. Okay? So at its center, it contains high concentration of the antibiotic. Okay? So once this filter paper disc touches the surface of the agar that is previously inoculated with the bacterium being tested, the antibiotic particles will move from the center going to the edge. I repeat, the antibiotic particles, okay, once this disc touches the agar surface, will move. No? The particles, the antibiotic particles will move from the center going to the edge. Okay? Until it forms inhibition zone. Okay? So again, after incubation for 16 to 24 hours, you will measure the diameter of the zone of inhibition or inhibition zone using vernier caliper or ruler. Okay, yes, you can actually use ruler to measure the diameter of the zone of inhibition. Okay, so I repeat, you will measure the diameter of the inhibition zone that was created after incubation using either vernier caliper or ruler. Okay? In terms of millimeter, the unit should be in millimeter. Okay? The last step in Kirby-Bauer test, again, is by measuring the diameter of the inhibition zone using vernier caliper or ruler. And then you will interpret, okay? You will interpret, so based on the diameter of the inhibition zone, you will interpret the result, whether it is sensitive, intermediate, or resistant. Okay? So, zone of inhibition surrounding the antibiotic disc indicating sensitivity. No zone of inhibition surrounding the antibiotic disc indicating resistance. How to prepare 0.5% McFarland turbidity standard, okay? First of all, what is the use of the 0.5% McFarland turbidity standard? It serves as the comparator block, okay? It's like a comparator block, okay? That will serve as your guide in preparing your standardized bacterial suspension. Okay? So here's how to prepare the 0.5 McFarland standard. You will simply mix 99.5 ml of 1% sulfuric acid plus the 0.5 ml of 1.175% barium chloride. Okay? So here's the chemical reaction. Please take note that one of the byproducts that will be formed is barium sulfate. Okay. And this barium sulfate, okay, will cause the turbidity of the McFarland standard. Okay? So I repeat, how to prepare 0.5% McFarland standard? You simply mix, okay, sulfuric acid and barium chloride. And one of the byproducts that will be formed is barium sulfate that will cause the turbidity of the McFarland standard. Okay? And then what you will do is that you will compare, okay? You will compare the 0.5 McFarland standard to the bacterial suspension that you are preparing, okay? So for example, this is your 0.5 McFarland standard. You will compare it to the bacterial suspension that you are preparing, okay? The standardized bacterial suspension, okay? So what you will do is that you will put side by side, okay, the 0.5% McFarland standard to the bacterial suspension that you are preparing against black lined background, okay? There's this special type of test tube rack which has black lined background, okay? The purpose of those black lines is for us to compare the turbidity of the 0.5 McFarland standard to the bacterial suspension that you are preparing. Okay? So again, you will compare, okay, the turbidity of the 0.5 McFarland standard to the bacterial suspension that you are preparing. Okay? So for example, this test tube contains NSS. Or normal saline solution. Okay, so what you will do is that you will get 2 to 3 or 3 to 4 colonies of the same morphology. Okay, and then you will suspend those bacterial colonies in this NSS. Okay, and then you check, you compare its turbidity to the McFarland standard. Okay. Compare. If the bacterial suspension is still too light, okay, compared to the turbidity of the McFarland standard, you add more. What you will do is that you will add more colonies. Okay, again, if the BS, the bacterial suspension, is too light, okay, you add more. What you will do, you add more colonies to the NSS, okay, until we are almost the same turbidity. So our objective is that the McFarland standard and the bacterial suspension that you are preparing should match, okay? Their turbidity should match, okay? What if the bacterial suspension is too heavy? Okay, you add NSS. Okay, what is the remedy? You add NSS. So reverse. Okay, again, our objective, our main objective here is that the McFarland standard and the BS should match with each other, specifically their turbidity. Okay, should match. So again, how to troubleshoot? If the bacterial suspension is too heavy, you add NSS. If it is too light, okay, you add more colonies. Okay? More colonies if it is too light. At the end of the day, what's most important is that they should match. Okay? So once the McFarland standard and the bacterial suspension that you're preparing already matched, okay, specifically their turbidity, you can already say, it is now safe to say that your bacterial standardized bacterial suspension that you are preparing is already standardized. We can already assume that this BS already reached 1.5 times 10 raised to the fifth CFU per ml. So once the McFarland standard and the bacterial suspension already match with each other, we can already assume that this bacterial suspension is already standardized. 1.5 times 10 raised to the fifth CFU per ml. Okay? And this bacterial suspension, this is the inoculum that we will use in the Kirby-Bauer test. Okay? So again, you match the turbidity of the McFarland standard and the bacterial suspension that you are preparing, okay, against black-lined background, okay? So our main objective here, the McFarland standard and the bacterial suspension should match with each other, okay? McFarland 0.5, and the adjusted test organism. Preparation of pure culture for susceptibility testing. Letter A. Pure inoculate or cultures are obtained by selecting 4 to 5 colonies of the same morphology, inoculate them into broth medium, and incubate for 3 to 5 hours to achieve a turbid suspension. Alternatively, 4 to 5 colonies, 6 to 24 hours of age, may be selected from an agar plate and suspended in broth or 0.85% NSS or normal saline solution to achieve a turbid suspension. Okay? This is the one that I'm explaining a while ago. Matching turbidity using the unaided eye is facilitated by holding the bacterial suspension here and the McFarland tube side by side and viewing them against a black lined background. Okay? So again, our main objective here, the McFarland tube and the bacterial suspension should match with each other. Okay? Specifically their turbidity. If the bacterial suspension initially does not match the standard turbidity, the suspension may be diluted or supplemented with more organisms as needed. Okay, the one that I'm explaining a while ago. If the bacterial suspension is too heavy, our remedy is you add more NSS. If it is too light, you add more colonies, okay, with the same morphology. Additional notes to remember about the Kirby-Bauer test. The diameter of the zone of inhibition around the disc is measured in millimeters using a vernier caliper or simply caliper. You can also use ruler as your alternative. The zone of inhibition is inversely related to MIC, means to say, the larger the zone of inhibition, the lower the MIC. Okay, the lower the MIC means more effectiveness from the drug. Okay, MHA containing 5% sheep's blood is used for testing streptococci and other fastidious organisms. Factors affecting zone of inhibition. Let's now discuss. Thickness of the susceptibility agar plate should be 4 to 6 millimeter in thickness. If the agar is too thick, zone sizes would be smaller. Or vice versa. If the agar is too thin, less than 4 millimeters, zone sizes would be larger. So again, the standard thickness of the MHA should be 4 to 6 millimeter only. Okay? Because if the Mueller-Hinton agar is too thick, more than 6 millimeter, the inhibition zones would be smaller and that will cause false resistance. Okay? If the agar is too thin, less than 4 millimeters, the zone sizes or the inhibition zones would be larger, and that will cause false susceptibility. Okay. The amount of inoculum or test organism should also be considered. So again, the standardized inoculum size should be 1.5 times 10 raised to the fifth CFU per ml. And how to achieve that? By comparing the turbidity of the bacterial suspension to the 0.5 McFarland standard. They should match with each other. So once the turbidity of the McFarland standard and the bacterial suspension already match with each other, we can already assume that the bacterial suspension is already standardized. Okay? The growth rate of the test organism should also be considered. Air at 35 to 37 degrees Celsius for most bacteria, 5 to 7% carbon dioxide for Neisseria meningitidis. If you want to perform EST for Neisseria meningitidis, it should be done, okay, inside a candle jar. Prolonged incubation may result in false resistance interpretation. So always make sure that you read the result. Okay, you read the result within 16 to 24 hours and not exceeding more than 24 hours. Because more than 24 hours, okay, prolonged incubation, that can cause false resistance. Okay, and lastly, the pH of the medium, okay, should be within 7.2 to 7.4. Decreased pH affects the activity of antimicrobial agents. Aminoglycosides and macrolides may lose their potency. Penicillin may have increased activity. Other factors, the number of discs per plate. Okay? Our rule is 12 discs or filter paper discs per plate. Okay? Placement of more than 12 discs per plate may result in overlapping zones, and that can cause erroneous results. The concentration of divalent cations such as calcium and magnesium can also affect the AST testing. Can affect testing of aminoglycosides and tetracyclines against Pseudomonas aeruginosa. And the last, so we are now down to the last AST method in our discussion, the E test. E stands for epsilon. E stands for epsilon. Epsilon is actually a company that manufactures those plastic strips which are being used in this particular AST method. Okay? So this is already the last AST phenotypic method that we will discuss, E-test. E-test is a dilution test based on the diffusion of a continuous concentration gradient of an antimicrobial agent from a plastic strip into an agar medium. E-test is almost similar with the Kirby-Bauer test. But instead of using filter paper disc, here we use plastic strips. Okay? Plastic strips. It's like a combination of the agar dilution method and the disc diffusion method. The purpose of this method is to determine MIC, or minimal inhibitory concentration. The positive result, or the shape of the inhibition zone here, is described as ellipse. This is what we call ellipse. Instead of circle, the shape of the inhibition zone is ellipse. So the positive result here is ellipse formation, ellipse of growth inhibition. T-test is not routinely done. Okay, this is, in fact, this is just an alternative susceptibility testing for fastidious organisms like Streptococcus pneumoniae and Haemophilus influenzae. Okay, so this is what we call plastic strip. Okay, the plastic strip that is being used in e-test. Again, E stands for Epsilon. It is named after the company, the manufacturer of those plastic strips being used in this method. Okay, so here are the parts of the plastic strip. It contains the antibiotic code, the reading scale, okay, in micrograms per ml. This plastic strip contains continuous concentration gradient of antibiotic. Okay? Means to say, class, the nearer the E, okay, so this is our reference point, the higher the antibiotic concentration. Like, for example, 64 micrograms per ml. The farther from letter E, again, our reference point is letter E, the farther, okay, from letter E, the lower the antibiotic concentration. So that's what we call continuous concentration gradient or of antibiotic or continuous antibiotic gradient. Okay? So all you need to do, class, is to put the plastic strips on the Mueller Hinton agar that is previously inoculated with the bacterium being tested. Okay? And then you will incubate for 16 to 24 hours or overnight incubation. After incubation, you will measure, okay? You will read, rather, the MIC. So let's take a closer look on one of the plastic strips. So again, this is what we call plastic strip. The plastic strip that is being used in e-test. E stands for epsilon. Okay? C stands for control. And T stands for test. Okay? So how to read this? After incubation, you will read the MIC. Okay? So how to read this? Okay, so here, okay, same question, what is the MIC? So how to read this? You will read at the point of intersection. Point of intersection between the plastic strip and the ellipse. In our example here. Okay, so same question. What is the MIC? The answer is 1 micrograms per ml. Well, as you can see, if you will look closely, okay, Not exactly one. Right? If you look closely, not exactly one. But it is closest to 1 micrograms per mL. Okay? So it will just depend on the clinician, or it will just depend on the med tech who will read the result. Okay? So just choose the antibiotic concentration which is closest. Okay? 100% point of intersection between the plastic strip and the ellipse. Okay? In our example here, the answer is 1. 1 micrograms per ml. Okay? Another example, the MIC is 0.25 micrograms per ml. For our first practice question, which method of susceptibility testing involves subjecting the isolate to a series of concentrations of antimicrobial agents in a broth environment? The correct answer is letter D, dilution. So we're almost done with our discussion about AST. What is the relationship of the zone of inhibition to the MIC of the test bacterium? If your answer is letter D, you're correct. Inversely proportional. When the laboratory can document a satisfactory performance of daily disc diffusion susceptibility QC, the frequency of performing this activity can be reduced to blank. The correct answer is letter C, every week. Testing for antibiotic sensitivity is often done by the blank method. The correct answer is letter A, Kirby-Bauer, also known as the disc diffusion method. It's the most commonly used AST phenotypic method. So letter A. In the semi-quantitative method of susceptibility testing, the concentration of the antibiotic is highest at the The correct answer is letter B, center. What method of antimicrobial susceptibility testing is based on the determination of an inhibition zone proportional to the bacteria susceptibility to the antimicrobial present in the disc? The correct answer is letter A, the disc diffusion method, or the Kirby-Bauer test. So that ends our discussion about AST. Thank you so much, guys, for listening, and enjoy the rest of your day. Always keep safe, always keep biosafe. Thank you so much.